And Paige is the manager of the grant, and then Trina Myers, who is new to our grant, and a coordinator that's helping. And they'll be here assisting today. We're going to talk, I'm going to talk, you're going to ask questions, we're going to dialogue as we go through the PowerPoint, first thing. Secondly, we've got some activities for you. This is experiential, but I do want to give you a PowerPoint and kind of an introduction. Now, you did get some materials that were sent out to you. White paper, boring, but it does tell you at least why ESSER came into being and a little bit about what it is. And then you watched a video. And which video did we ask them to watch? I forget. You did too. What video did you watch?
The Colorado.
Okay, good. That's a good introduction to ESSER. This training is going on all around the country with all kinds of different health professionals. Just in this grant, we're training medical students, nursing, we're training dentistry, interestingly enough. That's kind of a stretch at times, but we're training social work and VA. So we're really happy to be here. You're our only non-OU. You're very special in that regard. And we're really happy. Last year it was really nice to be here. Your professors are so accommodating and kind and welcoming, and as is you. So we're happy to come back. So please feel free to ask some questions as we go. If we get too involved in discussion, I may speed up and, you know, ask you to hold them. But I think we'll be okay. So I'd really like for you to feel like you can ask questions as we go. And let's kind of jump into the materials. Any questions as we get started? We're going to have 3 hours of it today, but again, it's not all me talking. So that's the good news. So ESSER stands for Screening, Brief Intervention, and Referral to Treatment. Basically, it's a way of organizing what we call a brief intervention, a way of approaching some of these trickier subjects that involve behavioral kinds of things, okay? It's just a way of approaching it. ESSER, you want to start with screening. We're going to talk a lot about that. It hinges on screening your general population. The brief intervention is where you're going to have a lot of skill building. And that brief intervention is where you spend some time working with those risky patients around some behavior change. And when I say brief, 5 to 12 minutes is what most people do, is the max when it comes to a brief intervention. And then referral to treatment, we're going to talk about those. Those folks that are definitely, say, alcohol dependent or major depression, you know they need specialized care. We're going to talk a little bit about how you refer them and use some of these skills we're talking about to complete a referral in the most effective way. Does that make sense? That's really all ESSER is. ESSER started out as a model simply for substance abuse and alcohol, including alcohol. It has since been tested and expanded to include tobacco, depression, and when I say depression, anxiety, kind of that spectrum. And that's kind of where it stands. But ESSER hinges on motivational interviewing. How many of you have heard of motivational interviewing? Okay, have you had it in another class at all, or where did you hear?
I
don't care. Who answers?
I've done the ESSER training before in Hawaii. So.
You've had this training?
Yeah.
From who?
It was in Hawaii.
Okay. It wasn't me, unfortunately. I haven't gotten to go to Hawaii to take the training. And what about you? You raised your hand as well.
Previous employment.
Oh, in employment. Okay, good. And was that in the mental health system or?
No, I used to work with a school system.
So okay, yeah. Good. So, you know, I said healthcare, and that's where it started, but it actually is a model that's being used in school systems and social service agencies in a variety of settings as well. So our goals is to identify their whole reason for ESSER. is so that you guys have a way of identifying people that may be using or having depression, experiencing an issue, that you can identify and be able to have an efficient and effective way of responding to that concern, right? I don't know, if a lot of people in the healthcare world used to, before this model, it's like, well, I don't want to get into this. It's such a can of worms. I don't know what to do with it. People's, once they start talking, they're going to talk forever, you know, or, you know, what if I don't evaluate it right? What am I going to do? This model will help you have some comfort in how to effectively do this. This is pretty much the standard of practice. And when you function within standard of practice, you know you're in kind of an acceptable place. So does that make some sense to everybody? Okay, so alcohol use is where it started, prescription and illicit drug abuse, tobacco, and then finally depression, anxiety. In your training, we're really gonna focus in on alcohol and depression, because that's what Dr. Britton felt would be the most useful to you all at this point in time. I'm not gonna spend a lot of time talking about how to take this model and use it for tobacco. I'm not gonna spend any time talking about illicit or prescription drug use, although it'd be a good idea with the amount of opiate use we have in the state. But we don't have time for everything, and if you really kind of get this, you'll be able to transfer these skills yourself without a lot of additional help and support, okay? So the examples I'm gonna use, we're gonna really stick a lot with alcohol because that's where the model started and that's where some of the best materials are. But when you do your simulation activities, your first one this Friday is an alcohol use patient. And then next week, 2 weeks, whatever it is, you will have a depressed patient, okay? And so you're gonna be able to not only learn this here, but then start that process of really trying these skills yourself.
Carrie, can I interrupt for 1 second?
Please.
This is completely technical. The slides that I've sent to you all, the email and everything that goes with it is not on a computer. I have no idea why it has been stripped off here. So I'm having them resend it back to me, and we've had some trouble getting it logged on. So just be patient. I don't think that these are something you have to take notes on. If you'll just stay with it, I will get these posted for you. So for those who are waiting for it, don't get anxious. Just go with this flow.
She's going to email it really fast to you.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm sorry.
It's okay. I'm going to keep talking without it. What this model does is take it from, you know, a tertiary care. If you know the public health model at all, you know, tertiary care is we've got someone with a diagnosable illness, we're going to try to treat their illness, right? And that's going to be a lot of what you do in life. But so many people also may be in a risky area, that their alcohol use is actually not to a degree that they're dependent or really need specialized treatment, or if you even sent them to specialized treatment, would they be accepted? Because they're probably not in that range of dependency. Now, you will find those people in practice, and we're going to talk about referring those people and using some of these skills to make that referral. But what we're really trying to do is find these people that are the at-risk population. So they're at risk of harming their health. They're at risk of potentially moving on to having some dependency or some social kinds of sequelae in their lives stemming from the alcohol use. Okay? Does that make sense? So we're trying to find those at-risk people. And that's the people you're going to do brief interventions with. They're not people that you would necessarily be able to diagnose as an alcoholic, right? Or a drug addict, or a major depressive disorder. When you have someone that you feel is up in that range, you do want to get another opinion. You do want to refer them. And you're going to use some of these skills I'm talking about to figure out how to do that. some of those motivational interviewing skills, which we're going to train you in. Okay. So now we're going to slide down. Oh, I thought you already sent it, sorry.
I think my computer thought you were trying to upload a virus into my system, so it just got blown away, did you? Oh, no.
Hopefully that's not the case. Okay.
I trust you implicitly.
The first step of ESPRT is, it's very obvious, is screening. And we talk about screening. It's real important, and this is starting to happen in lots and lots of practices. This model, again, started mainly as a tool for places that people frequent for their healthcare. It's not used as much in specialty care, but it honestly could be. Primary care practices, ERs, community health clinics, those are places that it's often being used now, and this model is being adapted. But screening is the first step. You need to screen everybody. It's really important that we don't try to say, well, we're only going to screen people we think are at risk. That it really becomes part of the standard questionnaires and part of your standard paperwork with new patients or annual kinds of visits with people. Different practices have figured out how to do it different ways that work for them. But it's really the concept that we screen everyone is a real important one. And we're going to talk about what screening looks like in just a quick second here. The results of this screening allows you then to have this conversation with those that you need to have a conversation with about the topic. Universal screening results in people being detected earlier who may have some things going on with their health related to their alcohol use or who have depression. And it's maybe not to the point that it would be as obvious. So you're trying again to find people a little earlier because it's a lot easier to treat, a lot easier to have this conversation and get some change going when it's earlier in the process. And then secondly, when you screen everybody, we make it a normal kind of process. And when it's a normal process, people aren't as defensive. If you try to screen only those you think may have a problem, then those people kind of understand that. They're going to feel more selected, and that raises the defense mechanism. So normalizing it by just making part of care and making sure that it's introduced in that manner really helps the whole process go a lot smoother with folks. So the reason that it's important for healthcare to take this on, and we may have touched upon this when we talked about geriatrics, but you know, in our universe, we've had this system of mental health and substance abuse care over here, then we've had physical health care over here, they've been pretty separate. We've expected, and I'm maybe overstating this a little bit, but I spent almost my entire 35-year career in healthcare. And the primary care and medical side of things often thinks that there's a whole other care system that's going to take care of substance abuse and mental health. The problem is that system is incredibly overtaxed. It's very, very hard to get into. And what are we doing?
Slides are up.
And only people in that dependent range are really going to expect care and treatment. So if we're ever going to get a handle on helping people avoid the high end, you know, the tertiary end of things, we want to find them earlier. And that gets back to where do people go? They go to primary care, they go to ERs, they go to schools, they go to social services. So having these conversations with people and helping educate them earlier can save people getting into dependency state or into major mental illness potentially. And you know, the final thing is, Well, it's not the final, I skipped the fact, alcohol and depression are often major factors contributing to many of the chronic diseases. And maybe even acute, you know, illnesses, especially trauma and injury, that you may be treating. And so really finding out what role these things are playing in that presenting problem can help you be much more effective in treating that problem. So there's that connection as well. They often go undetected. The standard that I've received care is there may be something on the intake form that says, do you drink alcohol? And most of the practitioners I talk to until recently say, yeah, we ask, but we never know what to do with it, and a lot of times there's just no follow-up on it whatsoever. And that's probably not a very good practice, because if you're going to ask, you probably do need to have a response. And so it goes undetected in healthcare, and so it is a factor. The alcohol use, the substance use, or the depression is often a factor that's influencing things in the background. So it's really useful to you as a practitioner to get good outcomes, that you get that out in the, you know, you understand what role and to what level these things may be contributing to that disorder, that care that you need to be providing. And then finally, people really are open to discussion, but a lot of times we think they're not. They're open to discussion if it's not in a judgmental way. And that's the beauty of what we're really going to spend some time talking about, is how to do this in a way that's not judgmental, that is normalized, and have a comfort level with the conversation yourself so that your client can engage better, or your patient. I say client because I'm a social worker, but I'll try to say patient. Okay, a lot of practices are starting this way. And when I say screening, there's really two phases of screening. There's what we call pre-screening, and then if the pre-screen is a positive, you go to a fuller screen. You will see something like this cropping up in different practices, primary care practices, potentially in ERs, or even specialty care practices. And this, we just normalize it, call it a stress questionnaire or a wellness survey, different tool, different titles you can use. But this is actually a series of pre-screens that have been evidence-based, that are used and standardized for this purpose. They're found to be sensitive, and they're found to be reliable for use in healthcare practices. These have been vetted and used. And so we embed them into, and you see up there also, if you're looking at it, the suicide question, and I know you've had some discussion of suicide. So we add that in. We actually, on the right-hand side, what you'll see are some things we're really not going to touch on, but violence, asking about violence in people's lives, and then asking about behaviors that could be related to PTSD. And so you may or may not have a population that you're caring for that you feel like it's important to ask all of these questions, but this is pretty typical. This is one that OU Physicians is using in most of its outpatient right now. And very similar to these are being used other places. Any questions about that? What this is are, these first two are what we call the GAD-2, which is general anxiety disorder. So those two questions are getting at people who may have some anxiety. If they have a positive, there's a fuller screen that you'd want them to get. And I'll show you that in just a minute. Then the second two questions are what we call the PHQ-2, and that is, again, a two-question screener. If someone answers positive to either of those, you would want to give them the full screen. And I'll show you what that one looks like. And then there's your suicide question. And then here are the audit C questions. That's the short version of the audit. If someone answers yes, a positive to those, you would want to go on to the full. And then finally, about illegal or misused prescription drugs, we call that the single question screener, if someone says yes. Now, a lot of times people say to me, well, do people answer truthfully? Has anyone been thinking that? Well, often, you know, it's a very legitimate question. You know what? There's not everybody's going to be 100%, you know, truthful. But this is the conversation starter. So when you have someone that you're talking with, you're able to review the screener and just say, so it looks like, you know, you're not using much alcohol at all. Is that correct? You know, and see if you can get a chance to get a fuller picture of someone and kind of give them a chance to talk about it in case they didn't quite go into the full picture in the screener. Does that make sense? But it gives you a way of doing that. So the nice thing is that what's happening with this is that this, ideally, the most efficient way of doing it is that this wellness screen is being electronically given to people in waiting rooms. You can give them an iPad and ask them to fill this out. If they answer a positive, it automatically brings up the full screen. So they don't even know that it triggered something. It flows seamlessly and then uploads into the EHR for use in the visit and in the future record. So that would be the nice way, and that works, and that's being developed, and some people are using that. A lot of the HRs aren't quite ready for that, but that's probably something you'll see, and how this works very efficiently in practice. If you're not able to use it electronically, then it's paper in the waiting room, and someone has to say, okay, there's a positive on this. Would you go ahead and fill out this further information for us? And then make sure it's in the chart and the practitioner sees it as they're getting ready to visit the patient. Does that make sense? I've already said it'll initiate a full screen, and then this information they report to you is the basis of starting your conversation. You've got a way of having a personal conversation with them based on the screening information. And you'll want to be sure you do look at it, not just at the score at the end, but at the things that they answered and their answers to those questions, because that's a way of having a good personal conversation. So I kind of said this already, but for depression, the PHQ-2 and then the PHQ-9. For anxiety, the GAD-2, then the GAD-7. Alcohol is the audit C, and then the full audit. And illicit and prescription drug use is the single question, pre-screen, and then what we call the DAST. And this is the audit questionnaire. I think you actually have that in your packet as well. Is that right? Okay. For example, your patient that you're going to see is going to have completed the full audit. You usually don't sit down face-to-face and give them this screening yourself. You would have them give it to themselves on paper, okay? Again, a lot of people say, well, are they going to be truthful? But you know what? A lot of times people are more truthful on paper than they are when you're like, tell me about this alcohol and how much. That often is very, very intimidating. And so when you're putting this as part of their screening in the waiting room and it's alongside the health questionnaire where they've been asked about, you know, their grandparents' diseases and there's, you know, a full picture of things that you're asking, it really kind of gets, again, that word normalized. So here are the, this is the first half of the audit. Okay, there's the first half, there's the second half. Um, alcohol, it's really important to clarify what size drink you're talking about. You're kind of going to have not the right information unless you do. A lot of the drinks out there are 2 or 3 drinks, and people might not know what a standard drink is. So any screening forms really need to include that information. And here is what a standard drink is considered for your information. So when you're scoring that test, it's really very simple. You just add up the responses. The responses are 0 to 4 for every question, and you add it all up, and you come up with this ranking. So for women and men, risk is a little different. Women don't get to drink as much before they get risky. When someone's low risk, we say brief education for everybody, even people who are low risk. But that brief education really can be, that's great, keep on doing that, you know, we'll look at this again in another year or two if you're in a family practice kind of setting. But if someone's really in that very minimal level, it's just, that's probably a good place to be. If someone's in this risky area here, for women, it's a score of 4 to 12, for men, 5 to 14. Then you're probably looking at doing some kind of brief intervention, and we're talking about, with alcohol, we're really talking about cutting back. We're not really talking about abstinence. And that's the other thing. If people kind of hear that right up front, that you're not talking about this in a judgmental way, you're talking about it in terms of their health. And, you know, probably just some looking at the drinking and, you know, are there places to cut back for someone in that risky. Someone in the harmful category, again, you're going to be taking all this into account depending on what you're doing with them medically and, you know, what their issues and concerns are and how great you think the risk is and they think the risk is of their alcohol use or if, well, we'll get to depression in a minute. We are alcohol only right now. When someone is in this area, it may be a brief intervention or you may be referring them to treatment. That's a kind of area you'll have to assess, and that would be based on your patient's response, partly, and your thoughts and how ready they are to go to treatment, if they're ready to go to treatment, and what you negotiate with them. Then in this category, you really should be have an agenda of being referring into some kind of treatment. Does that make sense? So you're kind of stratifying your response. Here's the patient health questionnaire, which is the PHQ-9, and this is the one that's assessing for depression. Same type of thing, only this one is 0 to 3, not 0 to 4, and you've got 9 questions, you total it up. And that total, here's the GAD-7, same idea, 0 to 3 are the responses, and there's 7 questions on this one. But for both the PHQ-9 and the GAD-7, you have a mild range, moderate severe, and then severe. Probably with that severe range of anxiety, depression, depending, unless you're psychiatry, you're looking at referring to specialty care for sure. Now, I didn't go into as much depth with this because with anxiety and depression, you will also be discussing with your patient potentially having some medications that you might give them for that and working on a treatment plan that involves maybe some medication as well as your behavioral component of what they could do to help with their depression. With alcohol, we're talking about usually the action is we want them to cut back and find ways of doing that, and we hope they'll discover some ways themselves of doing that. We're going to talk about how you do that. With depression, we'd be talking about behavioral activation. It may be that they need to work on sleep. It may be that they need to increase exercise, you know, diet, find more social engagement. There's a lot of different things. Alcohol seems like it'd be the harder one to work on. It's actually the easier in some regard than depression, which is why we have you doing that one first for your simulation activity. So in a brief intervention, what we're really trying to do is several things. Help patients understand their health risk, the association between alcohol or depression and their health concern, whatever that is. Now, their health concern may be they were in for high blood pressure, they were in for diabetes, they were in for, you know, different kinds of things. They may be in for an injury. Maybe they're a college student and they jumped off the roof at a party and, you know, after having four or five or six drinks, and they have a injured limb. And so they're there for that. So you're able to take that and relate and have a discussion around alcohol that relates to their healthcare concern. So what we're really trying to do is make sure that it's not about, I'm here to tell you you shouldn't be drinking because of some kind of moral issue, but I'm here to help you connect it to your health and your health status, and find a way of helping you do that, and you're here because you want to be healthy, and I'm here to help you do that. So we want to maintain that attitude. We hope they'll adopt or increase certain behaviors, and we want them to potentially give up certain behaviors. And so this is our method of trying to get to that. And then finally, for some people, we want to encourage them to accept more intensive care or treatment. And again, that could be a process. It may not be that the first time you see someone and you recognize they really are using a lot of alcohol and probably have some dependency. It may not be the first time they're ready. So it may be the second time you see them. It may be on some kind of follow-up visit. And that's going to take judgment and some assessment on your part. So here's kind of what this looks like. They'll come in, you know, for some reason into the healthcare system. Again, it could just be a checkup. Maybe they're having their annual health visit. But often they're there for some kind of other problem. You have screened them. And so we want to connect those two things to help with the awareness of the problem. Then once awareness is raised that these two things might be connected, we want to use that to enhance their motivation for some kind of behavioral change. And that's where we're going to spend a lot of time practicing some skills, is how do we help someone enhance their motivation? How should we talk to them? What are our tools for that? And we hope that this time that we spend with them will result in some behavior change, or at least in contemplation of behavior change and helping them move down the road in what we call the cycle of change. And we're going to look at the cycle of change in just a minute. Has anyone ever seen the cycle of change before? Oh, good. I mentioned before, 5 to 15 minutes is the most that you will spend in primary care doing a brief intervention. I'd say 15 minutes is really going to be a bit extraordinary, probably. You can have a good brief intervention in 5 to 8 minutes. You can. But we would encourage you to think about, especially with the SPs, I want you to think about going even longer if you can, because we're actually going to give you 12 minutes, I think, with the SP. 10? Okay. Going to give you 10 minutes with the SPs. And so you will have a full 10 minutes, and we'd encourage you to use that time for your skills practice if you can. Again, we're not trying to make you the person treating someone who's got a serious dependency issue. We're not putting you in that position. Or treating someone who's really suicidal or has a major depressive state or major anxiety state or hallucinatory, you know, psychotic state. those folks, you're going to use these skills to hopefully enhance their motivation to accept treatment. Okay, does that make sense? Motivational interviewing are the underpinnings of all of these skills that we're going to show you. Here's the cycle of change, and anyone who changes actually goes through this cycle. And you may go through it several times. Most of us do. How many of us have woken up one morning and said, by golly, I'm going to get rid of caffeine, right? And it's gone. And you do it, and you never see caffeine again. Is there anyone in the room that's been able to do it like that? Now, see, I had this brother that, you know, gave up cigarettes that way, and he did it for the rest of his life. And I was like, well, that's pretty amazing. Most people don't change like that, okay? We can't expect it. We need to understand the cycle of change. Most people will start with pre-contemplation. You're going to have people, when it comes to alcohol especially, that are going to, you're going to have them do the screener. They're going to come up with a score that puts them in the risky or even harmful range. And you're going to, you know, enlighten them about that. And they're going to say, I am thunderstruck, because they had no idea the level of drinking they were drinking would put them into that category. And so they would be someone we call pre-contemplative, because they really haven't had it brought to their awareness before. Okay? Now there's others that are going to come in and, you know, they go like, yeah, you know, I kind of wondered, my drinking has been going up now that you bring it to my attention. You know, and I have wondered if it contributes to anything that's going on. And so those people have actually had a little bit of contemplation. They would be in the contemplation stage. Someone who actually has been a pretty heavy drinker and maybe has even gone to treatment, they've gone through this entire cycle, right? And they probably relapsed. You see, relapse is actually a step in the cycle. Because all of us, as we're trying to change our behaviors, relapse. You know, I relapse on flossing, right? I relapse. Suddenly I'll just realize, oh my gosh, I've forgotten for a couple of days, right? And so you go right back in. Flossing, it just doesn't carry any baggage, so it's not a big deal. Alcohol carries baggage. So that's why we talk about making sure that we normalize the whole discussion and we put it into a context that people can hear us and relax enough to have a discussion. Does this make sense, this cycle of change? And that applies to every human being. Probably other mammals, frankly, but I'm not sure anyone studied that. So. The other underpinning of this is we're supporting self-efficacy. We want people to be successful. We want them to feel empowered. And this model is geared toward trying to make sure that happens. We're not about pointing out what people are doing wrong or the shortcomings. We're about trying to find what are positive steps they could take. What are things they've already done? What have they done effectively that could be a transferable skill? We're about those kinds of positive things in this model. And the patient is the one responsible for choosing and carrying out actions and change, not you. You're not responsible. Isn't that a relief? Yeah, Mark's like, yeah. Yeah.
We talked about this quite a bit, is trying to figure out who you are in the room as a provider.
Yes.
Not the controller, the coach,
right.
The encourager,
the facilitator,
but
right.
Not the one.
You're all of those things. You're the encourager. You know, I talk to people and it's like, oh, I just don't even want to get into all of this because people don't want to change. And it's their business whether they change or not. I might ask what they're doing, but if they want to change, they'll go do it. I also think that's the wrong answer, because I think you have to share information in your professional judgment, and also be the encourager and be the one with some skills that can help maybe shift the lens for that person just a little bit, so maybe they are ready, they become ready to take some steps. And you can play that role, and that's really what we're about. Okay, so a brief intervention, we saw the change cycle, but these are the steps of what we call that brief intervention that you're going to have. And when you're with your standardized patients, I want you to be going through these five steps with them in your head. You don't have to tell them you're doing five steps, but I want you to be thinking about these five steps. And we are going to practice different parts of this 5 to 10 to 15 minute process that you will have with a patient. You're starting with how you initiate this discussion. And the screening is actually part of that initiation. Without screening, you don't have really any basis to come into the room something to talk about. Okay? But with the screening, you do. Even if it's great job, glad, you know, that's good to know, keep doing that, because I don't really want you drinking any more than that because of your family risk for breast cancer or whatever, you know, different reasons you have. But you want to start with initiating this discussion. You want to provide some feedback on the screening that they had, and we're going to show you tools for doing that. Then you want to spend some time finding out what's their response to this. And this is maybe one of the most critical. They're all critical steps, honestly. But this is very important. You're not here to tell them what to do. You're not really here. You're going to share some information, but it's going to be the maybe 10 or 20% of the conversation should be what you think should happen. The rest of it should be finding out how to get them to reflect and come up with some of their own pluses and minuses and reasons for change and barriers to change. And you're going to do that. You're going to help them explore this personal meaning themselves. Then you're going to help enhance their motivation. And again, we're going to have tools that we're going to play with on that. How to do that. And then finally, by the end, we do want some kind of commitment. I'm not talking about someone getting to a point of saying, goodness, I'm going to give up drinking as soon as I walk out of the room. Thanks, doc. That was perfect. I'm talking about, okay, so you've maybe thought about, maybe you could take a step of cutting back, or you want to have a conversation with your friends or your husband first, and then you want to look at maybe decreasing your alcohol, and you've talked about a couple ways to do that. And so you're coming back for a check in 2 weeks or in 4 weeks. Let's talk about that again then and see how successful you were. So that's a fine enough plan for some, you know, for the first time. I'm not talking about a detailed page of, you know, at 12:58 I'm going to do this, and you know, then 2 days later, I'm going to decrease some more. I'm just talking about having a general idea that helps the person with their motivation and some commitment to you that they want to look at change. All right? So motivational interviewing skills are these tools that I keep referring to that help you have this conversation that leads to self-efficacy, that's non-judgmental, that's useful. And these are the skills that if you practice them will help your patient engage and relax and not be defensive. I say help. You can't always be, you know, able to control completely what, you know, someone else's response is going to be. But these will help to ensure the most satisfactory kinds of discussion relying on these skills. Motivational interviewing is based on this right here. You can come in the room and you can tell people all day long, this is what you should do, because I know. And it is not going to change very many people. There are a few people that it's like, I think my mom was one. She did everything the doctor said, but most people, not so much. They need to find their own reasons, and you need to give them the space to do that and support to do that. Remember when I said it's not about you telling them everything. It's about you asking the right questions and listening. And that's what motivational interviewing is truly based on, and that's the beauty of it. You know, we're talking about this with patients, but I invariably hear people come back and say, yeah, this was really good with my kids, you know, or my husband, or my parents, or, you know. And so these kinds of skills can be useful with your colleagues and lots of others as well. So we do want to, as we're going into the brief intervention, we want to find and use our MI skills to assess where the patient currently is in the cycle of change. We do that by asking questions. Have you had any thoughts about this before? Has anyone ever brought up your, you know, the amount of alcohol you drink, or has this been an issue in any of your prior care? Just some very basic questions like that. And that will help you know where that person is. Yes, I've actually cut back quite a bit, and things have been so stressful lately, I've actually increased again recently. So you know that, you know, that's a different conversation with that person than someone who says, "Not, this has never been an issue. I'm not an alcoholic. I drink less than anyone I know. Why would you even bring this up with me?" And you might get that from some people. In front of you, you have a card. And here's kind of where we are. This is alcohol specific, the card. We don't have one for you on depression. You will use this card in your alcohol intervention with people a lot. The limits that have been established after reviewing mounds and mounds and mounds of data and literature and meta-analysis and this and that and the other, for men, to be in the low-risk category, you need to be under 14 drinks a week and not routinely drink 4 drinks or more a day, okay? Women, not as lucky, 7 drinks a week. That's not very much alcohol. So you're going to have women who are like, what? That's just 1 glass of wine a day. I've been told up to 2 is okay, you know? And really, that people have been. There was a report came out not long ago that even at 1 glass of wine a day, it appears the risk for breast cancer is enhanced significantly. So things are moving around even with that. But that's the established drinking limits. Now, you know, if I had somebody that was at 7 drinks and they were a pretty healthy person and they're younger and, you know, there's really nothing going on, I think my advice would be, well, you know, just know that going much beyond that may have some consequences for you. You may want to look at holding it there. And it may not be the biggest priority you have with that patient. You're always going to be finding your priorities with that patient, right? So for some people who are at that cutoff, you know, or in that range that's right around the cutoff, there may be patients that you don't think should be drinking at all because of medications that they're taking or some other issues. So, you know, these are guidelines, and you're going to have to use them in the bigger picture of what you know about your patient and how you're managing your relationship and your care and treatment. So anyone over 65 is at the same cutoff as women. How it breaks out is about 80% of your patients are going to be in the healthy, the low risk range, and you're going to say, good job, stay there. Well, you're going to say a little bit more maybe than that, but that's about it. And then about 10%, 9 to 10, are going to be in this risky range. People that get up into this harmful range where, you know, you may spend a little more time even with them, and it may become a bigger priority. And then certainly these folks you're going to be looking at, I need to, you know, it is my obligation to try to discuss treatment with them, okay? In this area in here, these folks in that orangey gold, they may want to go to, you know, you may send them for further assessment with a specialist. Again, that's going to be kind of hard. You're going to have to manage that depending on your setting, depending on your relationship, what their willingness is, and so on. So in motivational interviewing, we definitely want to link the screening to the brief intervention. We're going to talk about skills for that in more depth in a minute. We're going to use MI strategies, help this person find their own reasons and their own compelling reasons to reduce their alcohol or change the behaviors that might alleviate some of the depression. We're going to help them get ready to try their change activities, and we're going to help them be more committed. That's what you're trying to do. And the spirit of motivational interviewing is it's very collaborative. This isn't about your agenda or you trying to, you know, somehow subtly, you know, coerce them. It is just about you being a place they can begin this thinking process and you supporting them and using your skills to help move them along. It respects their autonomy and it's very compassionate. I mean, again, none of us find change to be all that easy. You know, there's a few things that I go, yeah, I'm going to do that, and it's not that hard. But for the most part, when you're changing something that's been an ingrained part of your life, it's going to take some time to go through that change process, and it's going to take repeated cycles through the change process. MI is evidence-based, it's patient-centered, it gives you a structure, and it's very adaptable. We're going to practice some of these core MI skills. You will not come out of this class being a proficient motivational interviewing expert. You will get some of those core tools that you can use and use in a lot of different ways in your practice. And those four skills we're going to focus on are open-ended questions, affirmations, reflections, and summaries. So readiness to change, I like to highlight this because I hear people all the time saying that person isn't going to change. But people do change. All of us change. Every patient that walks through your door is going to change something in their lives, I guarantee you. Or they don't stay alive, frankly. You've got to be adaptable. We have to find, it's up to us, to set the stage and to make it as inviting and help them see the vision as much as we can. Again, you can't make it happen, but you can certainly enhance the possibility and enhance the probability by how you respond and talk with them and engage with them. So it's a state of mind, it's not a trait that a person has or doesn't have. I'm going to cover real quick referral to treatment. Then after the break, we're going to start with really kind of going into this brief intervention and how to do it in a lot more detail. But I want to talk about referral to treatment, kind of get that down. First of all, substance abuse treatment and mental health treatment, they really do work. We hear a lot about relapse. We hear a lot about ineffective care. But the world of treatment really has come quite a long way. And it is something that you should try to understand when you're going into practice. You should be able to figure out where are your resources. I'm not going to spend a lot of time telling you all the resources because I have no idea where you're going to practice. Right? And your resources are going to vary from, you know, geography a great deal. And each person is going to have access to different resources, of course, in our country, based on their insurance and their income levels. So it's a very complicated system in a lot of ways. I'm not going to say otherwise. when you're trying to make referral, here's some just basic things to remember. That treatment can be counseling and therapy on an outpatient basis, but there's also, of course, various levels of inpatient care. And, you know, again, it depends on whose insurance covers what, who's going to be available to which people, under what circumstances. There's other psychosocial for people with serious mental illness. There's often a lot more care available for, than those who have a lesser level or not as established care. The Community Mental Health Center is awfully good about providing ongoing care to people with long-term serious mental illness. I say good, it's probably one of the richest benefit packages out there for folks. But most of the time, what we're going to be talking about is you're seeing people whose conditions are emerging. So you're going to want to know about outpatient evaluation services. And for those folks that are suicidal or homicidal or, you know, really, really worrisome or really need medical detox for alcohol, you're going to want to know where those resources are and how to access them. There's also complementary for folks that don't need immediate intervention. There can be complementary wellness. I mean, there's a huge increase in the use of mindfulness, meditation, yoga, a lot of stress reduction to help folks that have a mental illness, and that may go hand in hand with medications. And you'll be seeing those services in other places across the country. Okay. I've already kind of covered inpatient, residential, partial, outpatient, intensive programs. There's methadone clinics, replacement clinics for those that are into, that have a substance abuse disorder, non-alcohol. Let's see if there's anything here. I need to scoot up just a little bit. Inpatient treatment really is reserved for those with the most serious, and it's often a little difficult to get into. And especially, you know, you may have had, have you spent some time on referring to inpatient care, Dr. Britton?
Not to a large extent. We just got bipolar and depression up there, and we've kind of covered some of the therapeutic information, but we really haven't gotten into how to do stuff.
And at some point, and this is not the class that you're going to get in-depth assessment of when someone does say yes to that suicide question, what to do. I will tell you my own personal answer is that all primary care needs to have a social worker embedded. So you can say, here, would you handle this? And they will be there to, you know, help with that. I think you are seeing that happening more and more places where you have a mental health practitioner who is embedded, or at least in the same building, but really embedded closely in the practice so that you're practicing side by side. And people really love that model because they love coming for mental health care where they come for their primary care. It decreases the stigma and it coordinates care and makes sure that it's synced, and you know, you've got a team of people working for you and not disparate populations or disparate providers who aren't communicating well. So, determining if your patient is alcohol or drug dependent, and there's different tools for doing that, but if they are dependent and need medical detox, you're going to really need to make sure that you can refer them to the medical detox. But these would be people who are clearly dependent. Determining if that patient, if they are depressed, if they're very suicidal or homicidal, then again, you're talking about inpatient care and treatment and about or evaluation, referring to evaluation for those folks. Non-dependent or depressed is usually treated as an outpatient unless there are other serious risk factors. So that's kind of how that's determined. And when you're making a referral, you want to make sure your patient is ready. You have had time, or your staff, someone has had time to really sit with that person about what this referral is going to look like.